sick.
Crazy.
Out there.
A person's worth is measured by not only how many people love them, but how many people hate them.
Over the past several years, there's been a marked increase in the number of exceptionally violent.
I think our music is a release of aggression.
Hateful.
I speak about hate and I show the reflection of hate.
Racist.
If I hold up a picture and people call me a racist, then that's what they're feeling inside themselves.
Anti-woman songs that are not only out in the market, but in many cases are topping the charts.
I think our fans are some of the only few intelligent people in America, and everybody else are the ones that are missing the point.
So I think Marilyn Manson is adult entertainment. I don't think teenagers like under 18 should be there anyway.
We're going to shut you down because what you propose is not uplifting. It's not helpful. It doesn't advance the culture.
I think if anyone was afraid of what might go on at a Marilyn Manson concert, they should take their kid with them. People gravitate towards sensationalism, and the media feeds it. And you can either be manipulated by it or you can make it part of your art. And I just try and make it part of what I do.
You know, it's easy to write stories, but it's hard to kind of put your whole life into perspective. And it makes you think. Like when I finished the book, it kind of changed my opinion on myself. And I think it will drastically affect stuff that I do in the future, like our new album that we're working on.
Was the point of the book to set the record straight on all of the myriads of rumors that have been floating around for the last few years?
In some ways. You know, because I just got sick of answering the same questions about being on the Wonder Years. And
how did that one get started?
God, we're tired of that one. We're not even you.
How about the breast implants? Is that true or is that a rumor?
You're
flat as hell. Those are bad breast implants, if that's the case.
Yeah, get your money back, man.
Denny Jones gave me these breast implants.
Right. So, yeah, and of course, you know, we reported weekly when on the last tour, you know, who knew what was rumor and what was true, but the stuff that was being written about you and your band and your stage show was just the most ridiculous stuff I have ever seen. It was so obvious that these are people who have never been to a Marilyn Manson concert.
I gave them credit for being creative, though.
They were talking about you doing live sex on stage, and that you were gonna, there was the one rumor on the Halloween show. Remember, you were going to commit suicide a couple of years ago, and people were really pumped for that.
Well, there's generally a rumor that I die about once every 2 weeks, so yeah. I have to just kind of keep press releases out. Sorry, I'm still alive.
Especially with, it's such a different world now that the internet is out there. I mean, those rumors can spread around the world in a day.
It's man has kind of created Big Brother for himself with the internet.
You like it or do you hate it? Or do you care?
I think it's the CB radio of the 90s.
Yeah.
It's a bunch of idiots that are kind of hiding behind the secrecy. The anonymity.
Having said that, by the way, your fans, though, seem to really flock to the internet. I mean, you've got so much support on the web and so many groups that are devoted and dedicated to you.
It has the potential to be something great, but right now I think it's kind of dangerous because there's no law, there's no protection against what's real and what's not.
Which I would imagine you're a fan of, by the way.
Yeah, if people realize that, it's just a tool for communication and it's not the news, then it's fine. But
bingo, yeah.
That's what the problem for me was last year. There were these Christian groups accepting these rumors as fact because they read it on the internet.
If you people knew, I don't know how much some of the listeners pay attention to what Marilyn has gone through just trying to mount a concert tour.
Yeah.
The lengths that these venues go to keep your band out of there is insane. Arbitrarily imposing curfews, for instance, and telling you, you know, what lyrics and what songs and what T-shirts you can sell.
Or you can't talk between songs. And all that kind of stuff.
I don't know of any artist who has had to endure what you have in the 90s, certainly.
Well, Mariah Carey. But other than her.
Obviously. I mean, did you ever feel defeated by that? Did you ever feel like it was just too much trouble to go out and try to stage the show you wanted to do?
No, it really made it more exciting and more worthwhile because I felt like it had a cause, and I knew I wasn't doing those things. I knew that the show was provocative, but it wasn't what they were saying.
It was kind of challenging, kind of fun.
Yeah, there was the most dangerous part, I would have to say, is that there were a lot of bomb threats, and they'd bring in bomb dogs. But some people don't know, bomb dogs are the same dogs that sniff out drugs.
Right.
So we were always paranoid when they had these dogs sniffing around our dressing room.
Sure.
They would always bark at Twiggy's face for some reason.
Well, I bark at Twiggy's face when I see him. But let me just ask you this, because I need some clarification, because I'm a little confused. I did flip through the book. So you're a high priest in the Church of Satan, correct?
You know,
name that.
That was...
It's kind of unofficial?
Yeah.
One of those
Okay. It was one of those things like when you get a Boy Scout badge, like for walking an old lady across the street, mm-hmm. for being like the most evil guy in America. They gave me the.
Hey, congratulations.
Hey, way to go.
We're happy for you. Good
Parents
work.
Must be proud.
Dad, do you call home on something like that and go, Dad, I've got great news? And the Church of Satan is it a real like place that people can go? I mean, do they have congregations? And
no, it's more of just a philosophy that Anton LaVey died
recently,
last
yeah.
October.
That's
so,
right.
So I think you know his. To me, he's just like Nietzsche, Voltaire, Freud, all these people
who've
had...
He's just a thinker.
Thinker.
Right. But the Church of... This is the last point I'll make on this. The Church of Satan, though, is not devil worshiping, or is? Because the impression I got from your book is that it's not.
No, I don't even believe in Satan.
You know, it's not at all. I mean, it's
how can the Church of Satan not believe in Satan, for God's sake?
That seems ill-named.
It's they kind of adopted the title Satanism in kind of the definitive rebellion, like a Satan,
well,
as being the definition of rebellion.
Do you think that they would be upset about the fact that you're wearing a gold scarf today?
I don't think so. I think gold scarfs are a big part of Satanism.
Okay,
you don't.
It kind of diffuses.
It does diffuse.
It does, yeah.
You come in a gold scarf and go, hey, how much trouble can he cause? He's got a gold
and
scarf.
And wouldn't the devil be wearing a gold scarf?
Eddie Stylish.
That's a good point.
You don't believe in God?
I don't really believe in anything specifically except myself. That's what I've learned over the years.
Heaven and hell, same thing, right? It's just...
Heaven and hell is kind of like 818 and 213.
Very close together. Okay, cool. I'm clear on that. What kind of drugs do you do, Marilyn?
I try and stay away from them all right now.
Really? Is that true? You're clean right now?
No. Do you believe it?
Do I?
You keep believing what he says.
That man is just a liar.
How foolish are you?
Cocaine? You like cocaine?
I don't think anyone likes it because it makes you poop your pants.
You do enormous quantities, though, in some chapters in this book, though. I mean, you really pack the stuff away.
You misused the words poop your pants.
I know he did. But I read a quote from you in the paper or something this week where you talked about how you're not an addict.
No,
and you're pissed off at drug addicts, right?
Yeah, I just think, you know, you should be able to, you know, be a professional drug user. If you're going to use drugs, do them right.
Do it safe. Don't be an addict. Don't be addicted to it so that you become a loser.
Yeah, sure.
You're for the legalization of all drugs?
Oh. That wouldn't be any fun.
So you like to do it because it's illicit?
Yeah.
A little bit.
Yeah.
I see. You've done it. Have you ever had a scary situation where you've been like really sick from doing too much? Because it sounds like sometimes you just really overdo it in the book.
Well,
any regrets on that?
There's a couple instances in my past. You know,
when have you gotten really sick? And
I never really got sick. It wasn't that type of... A drug thing.
You just have. You must have an amazing constitution.
Yeah. Well, being on tour, you become sort of superhuman in a lot of ways.
I mean, Marilyn looks healthier than 80% of the guests we have in here, and with the way he lives his life, it's incredible.
That's the key. You make your body a place where germs don't want to live.
I like that.
That's good advice. You are in the studio right now here in Los Angeles working on a new record. How's that going?
We're about halfway done. Like I was saying early on, writing a book kind of changes the way you think. So the last album in the book were very transformational for me. And I think this record will be something people don't really expect.
Like religious, you were saying. It's not religious.
No,
for
it's not. It's not
but you
religious.
Said you put hand claps on it. Was that a lie, too?
Well, I put hand claps on a song, you know. It lightens things up.
People get happy. You were telling us off the air. Was that off the air or on the air? I'm getting confused now that people get happy when they hear hand claps.
Yeah, it makes people smile.
I think that'll be good.
That's what you're all about, too.
Now, the record's more... the last album was about stripping away mm-hmm. all emotions. This one is kind of about what it's like when they come back. And it's like being a person that doesn't belong in a world. So it's... I think it's something that people won't expect.
And dreams were responsible for a lot of the lyrics in Antichrist Superstar, right?
Absolutely. I mean, they continue to be an influence. Right. The next record is really based off of a dream about me kind of going off into space and coming back in the world being in a totally different place.
Wow.
So I continue to kind of just get really involved into what happens when you're asleep just as much as when you're awake.
Right. All right, let's take another call. Hello?
Hi.
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 This is Erica. I have a fast story for you right before I ask you my question. I created an 8-foot by 6-foot painting of you last year as a school project, but because so many were against it, because they had preconceived notions about you, but because of your influence on me, which is very positive. You gave me the strength and inspiration to complete it, even though many were against it. And I would like to thank you for that, and I also would like to give it to you as a gift. But I have to go to my question now. Do you ever get creatively frustrated? If so, how do you handle it?
I think I always get creatively frustrated. That's part of anybody's process of making things. If you were happy doing what you do all the time, I don't think anything great would come out of it.
Let's talk a bit about one of the things, the songwriting process of the band, because a lot of people have been interested in how you come up with the songs themselves. With the writing process, is it you always usually start as a riff thing before the lyrics? Do you do lyrics and poetry type?
In the past, I think we mostly gravitated towards narcotics and alcohol, and then whatever happens, happens.
Right.
And I kind of would go and adapt that into some lyrical concepts. But writing this new record, we took a more conventional approach and kind of Beatles, Bowie, Pink Floyd, sort of sitting down with he and I with an acoustic guitar and trying things differently, and I think it really paid off for us. It made our songwriting grow from where it was before. The next record is much more about alienation and trying to fit into a place that you've been sort of exiled from. And growing up, those bands, I could identify with music on that level, and it inspired it that way, and sonically too.
Yeah, so I mean,
albums like the White Album or even Diamond Dogs or The Idiot, which Bowie produced for Iggy Pop, and the sound of that record and the feeling of it, quite depressing.
With the, you worked together with Trent producing the last record, and Dave Ogilvie was involved for a little while. Who have you thought about for producing this next record when the time comes?
So far we've done everything on our own as much as we could. We tried working with the Dust Brothers a little bit, and that was interesting. And we worked on a friendship level with Corgan, your twin brother. And I don't know, we're testing the water and a few more people to see who's going to finish it up. But
and what has Billy's role been in, and I mean, you've been friends for a while, kind of have a lot, so what kind of role is he taking place? It's kind of like a musical consultant thing. Is he co-writing or anything?
At this point, he's just offered his opinion by listening to the music. But we're probably going to write a song or two together, either for his record or ours, but it's for our own enjoyment as friends, I suppose.
It's great.
Anyway, this is a latest album, Mechanical Animals. The ongoing chapter in the life of Marilyn Manson. Obviously a new look, a new sound. Is that a conscious effort, or you just felt it was time to maybe vary things up a bit?
Well, just with my personality, I feel the need to grow. I get bored easy. I think it would have been silly to repeat what I already did. So because the last album changed me so much, or writing a book changed me, this is kind of the result of the change, second part to the story.
Well, we'll talk about some of the changes a little bit later, but you've always cited Bowie, Mark Bolan as huge references, always, but why now? Why this album for an obvious nod to that sound, to that period?
Well, seven of the songs on the album are kind of an homage to what people make me out to be, sort of an icon. The other seven songs are more internal. And because the record was about me putting myself back together again after stripping away all my emotions, I was thinking about my childhood a lot. So the music that I liked growing up was very inspirational on this record. I think so. It's right now it's kind of a struggle to put rock and roll back in the mainstream, in general. So I think kind of like pulling a lot of weight for other bands as well, because rap music is so strong in America. There isn't any real rock stars, and something that I've still been fighting for all these years.
Now, the reference to drugs comes up a lot on the record. And I'm just wondering, because you've admitted in doing a lot, or experimenting a lot, is there something you're trying to say with the song?
Well, the whole album, I speak about this unobtainable entity called Coma White, which at times could be looked at as a drug or a person or even the fans or even myself. And I try and point out on the album that drugs kind of go beyond the obvious, and that it kind of exists in just people's need to suppress their feelings. As I started to gain back all my emotions and talk about them on the record, I began to see the rest of the world as being very mechanical. And drugs, you know, as a metaphor, are how people suppress, you know, being actually human, you know, with religion or with television or whatever you want to, you know, choose.
Do you still look down on the, you said, sort of the herd mentality, the sheep mentality that goes along with following a faith, where there is no room for individuality?
Well, Antichrist Superstar examined that on a lot of different levels. It even examined the herd mentality of rock and roll. And I think by looking at that, it made all of us smarter. It made the fans smarter. It made me smarter. I think it gave us all the perspective to realize that Christianity and rock and roll are very similar in a sense. And if you can see that, you can point out your own hypocrisy, then you can go above it. You can try and be realer than anything else.
Is that message getting out, though? Because for the most part...
Ask these people.
Yeah, well, looking around, though, they're still dressed in black.
Well, that's good now, because I'm not, so they're not imitating me. They're being themselves. They're doing what they want to do. I think everybody's just trying to, you know, it's also the idea that everyone can be a star. You know, you look around, you see these people, they're going to stand out on a street corner more than anyone else, and that's their first step at, you know, being what they want to be.
Were you at all comfortable with the goth tag?
Goth music's, you know, been something that I've liked. I don't think I ever wanted to be limited to that.
So this album almost was a...
Well, I think parts of this record are more goth than the last one, if you want to look at it from, you know, that point of view. But, I mean, labels are for journalists, you know. I think it's just rock and roll. That's what it's always been to me.
Okay. The, what you wore in Dope Show, some might say could be representative of a feminine side to you. Would you agree with that, or maybe a new discovery?
To me, it was the image on the album cover was to represent vulnerability. It was to represent an undefinable persona, to represent sexlessness and both sexes at the same time. So it did have feminine elements, but it was also sexless at the same time.
Let's talk about mechanical animals, if you like.
Okay.
All your previous releases have carried very strong messages. So I'd like you to first tell me a little bit about this album, the underlying theme behind it, or what it represents for you.
Well, our last record, Antichrist Superstar, was a lot about stripping away emotion and to try and become something that superhuman. And this record is kind of what happens afterwards, dealing with the repercussions of that. It's a lot about gaining back my emotions and gaining empathy and almost trying to become human and looking at the rest of the world. And the more that you look at it, the more people appear to be these mechanical animals that look and act like humans but don't really have souls or personality inside. So the album's a lot about me trying to put my life back together.
Obviously, the Antichrist Superstar is a lot less present on this album. Is this something that you still feel strongly about? Is this something that you still see in yourself?
Yeah, I think that's something that I'll still see in everybody. But I think it was something that I expressed the best that I could, and there was no reason to continue to deal with that subject. In some ways, mechanical animals is the flip side or the opposite of that. If that was like a fall from grace, this is what happens when you land.
Mm-hmm. I was reading through the lyrics, and there's a few things that came onto mind. One thing was that, obviously, for Antichrist Superstar, you did focus a lot on the American ideal, or should I say anti-ideal. Mm-hmm. But with this album, obviously, you're a bit more open. So you did tour a bit around the world for Antichrist Superstar. And the experience that you had with other cultures, how much of an impact did that have on the actual lyrics of Mechanical Animals?
Well, I guess subconsciously, maybe it made the record less centered around American ideals,
yeah,
and more in a timeless, spaceless place. You know, it's more universal, I guess, in some ways.
A lot of mention about death and love as well. I don't know if you agree with me here.
It's kind of the fear of emotions.
It
kind of comes out more on this record because, like I said, in the past I was kind of numb to everything, and now feeling them. I guess the best way to describe it was Antichrist Superstar was about wanting an apocalypse, whether that was a personal one or you know, the mythical one that people have expected, you know, this century. And this record is almost trying to stop it, because now I found a reason not to want one, but it's too late. You know, I think it's because I've started to feel and have empathy for people. And so it's kind of a more of a tragic story.
So would that be the parallel with death coming in repeatedly in the lyrics? Or like the term death, the idea? Or?
I suppose so. I think that, you know, I've always kind of seen things from a tragic point of view, and that's just part of my personality. And this record is, you know, I suppose it's a tragic story in some way.
Could you tell me about this? This is very interesting, and it also comes back in the video, of course. Do you like the idea of yourself as a hermaphrodite? Because that's the word for it, half man, half woman?
Well, it is both androgynous, but it's also sexless at the same time.
Yeah. What does that mean?
Well, I think it's kind of how a combination of how the world sees me and how I see myself. And a movie that I used to watch a lot and recently was really inspired by making this record was called Fantastic Planet. And it's...
I don't know it.
And it's about these creatures that kind of study the humans and keep them as pets. And a lot of the images that I use were inspired by that cartoon.
Okay. In the song Dope Show, you're talking about the pretty ones.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as much as I know, LA is very much a city where people want a piece of fame. They want to look beautiful. Everything has to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a parallel to be made with the pretty ones in the Dope Show?
It's very much about Hollywood. It's very much about how, you know, I think the pretty ones is even the same reference that I made in Beautiful People as well.
Yeah.
So Beautiful People was more directed at religion, and in the Dope Show, I'm more talking about the trappings that come with fame, you know, sycophants and people that want to, you know, drain you.
Mm-hmm. So who are the pretty ones?
Well, I mean, usually the people who don't realize that they're the pretty ones.
There's the term white that comes in also a lot. If I have a bit of a blind, coma white, world so white, big white world, white sun, our God is white. Anyways, I'm sure you know them all, and I could go on. Can you explain to me the your use of the term, the color?
It's kind of, it represents a draining away of all feeling and of color and emotion. White is kind of empty, and it's about an emptiness. And I wrote most of the album in a room at my house that was painted entirely white with all white furnishings, and it was just part of, I guess, my mood, and it was, maybe I was trying to fill it up with something, maybe with my emotions, but mostly represents emptiness.
Do you think art should be provocative or extreme. I mean, this to some people might be a little provocative.
I'm sure all art isn't intended to be, but I really couldn't create anything any other way because that's the way I operate, kind of with extremes.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, that's what all great art comes from, is not being afraid to take chances.
Yeah. What about criticism that goes with it, with extremes?
Well, criticism, you know, provides for stimulation. If people are talking about it, whether they love it or they're criticizing it, they're still talking about it. So that's kind of the basis for what all art is supposed to be. You know?
Musically, I was surprised that this album wasn't a lot what I had expected. It's a lot softer, a lot more melodic. There's a lot of funk in there, almost new wavy, I found. What inspired you to go that way for Mechanical Animals?
Lyrically, where I was coming from was a lot a wider spectrum of feelings than sometimes I've had in the past, and the music kind of had to represent that as well. So I just think it's a more dynamic record, and it is more melodic. It's not really afraid to be bombastic in a rock sense.
Okay.
You know, it's the arrangements and everything is, you know, inspired by a lot of the music that I liked growing up. It was like Queen and Bowie and mm-hmm. Iggy Pop and T-Rex and things like that.
How do you think the Manson fans, the Antichrist Superstar fans, or even the previous ones, will react to seeing Marilyn Manson showing his emotions out in the open like that?
Well, I'd like to hope that if I've grown from making the music, that the fans would grow from listening to it also, and that mm-hmm. this would be a natural desire for them to experience the same things I'm experiencing.
Okay. Can you explain that to me? How do you think the world perceives you or sees you?
Well, I think they see me as something that is otherworldly, and sometimes that provides for a fascination, and sometimes that scares them. So sometimes they want to enjoy it, and other times they want to destroy it. So
does that please you?
I suppose so, and it's just a strange position to be in, so mm-hmm. that's kind of where I wrote from on this album.
What is it that, as a performer, as an artist, what is it that you want to achieve? What is it that you've set out to achieve?
Well, with this record in particular, I've set out to redefine the boundaries of rock and roll, to bring back you know, the strength of what rock and roll stands for, and not to let it become a product or disposable.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want to express the way I see the world, you know, and it's fortunate that people want to listen to what I have to say, but it's mostly so that I can deal with the way I'm thinking, and I've used music to express it.
Mm-hmm. And what point do you feel that you're at in achieving this?
I think Mechanical Animals is really the beginning for us. A lot of people would think Antichrist Superstar was the pinnacle or the best thing that we could do or the farthest we could take it, but I've really just started now, so I think it's a long ways off before I do all that I have to do.
Have you found or been able to tap into any hidden powers that you say, wow, you know, the will plus imagination does equal magic here? That I can do something a little bit different and special?
I think my success in what I do is a good example of that. I couldn't find a better example. You know, I've taken my will and I've taken my creativity and I've done the best I could with it. I think that in itself is magic, you know, if you have to demystify it by calling it something.
And how do you feel about the fact that you are passing this aesthetic on to so many kids now, because so many people, you're influencing so many other people now?
Well, I hope that it'll make them, you know, find expression in themselves more. I hope it'll make them, by seeing someone being themselves, that it'll inspire them to do the same, or it'll inspire them to ask questions or just to be interested in anything, because it seems these days that a lot of music doesn't inspire you to do anything, you know. Well, I'm always trying to break things down, because, you know, people's differences and people's fears are only as powerful as they make them. And if I can attack them or talk about them or get people to think about them more, then it changes the boundaries and it makes, often makes people think, be more open-minded, and I think that's kind of positive in a way. The last record was so much stripping away emotions, and I kind of found myself almost alienated, coming back to a world that seemed different, because I'd seemed like I was gone. I came back, and now I have more feelings, more emotions, more empathy, and a lot of that plays into what the record is about. How people often go about their lives looking and acting like human beings, but not really having anything inside, whether it's a soul or their creativity, and thus leaving them to be mechanical animals. Because the song is an indictment of Hollywood and the rock and roll lifestyle.
Because it is all about the famous, rich and beautiful here, and there is such an effort made to be all those things.
I've tried my hardest to be as unappealing and as unattractive as I could be. But Courtney wins that one.
Billy Corgan was saying that he sort of put you on this path of a new kind of sound, maybe a new look. Would you agree that there is sort of a new chapter in the life of Marilyn Manson with this?
Well, Antichrist Superstar was very transformational, and the sound and the look of the band was what was the only thing that could result from that. Billy Corgan did provide encouragement to take our musical direction as far as we could go. But he wasn't any sort of director in our path, but just a friend. And I think this record kind of is a new chapter. Kind of, this is the beginning for us, where some people would have thought it was the end.
When the band's album Antichrist Superstar was released in America, the beautiful people went out and bought it in their millions. But the album also upset and deeply offended millions.
Antichrist Superstar for me was written to represent a transformation and an apocalypse. And for me, it became a personal apocalypse. So I pushed myself towards death, towards everything that I was thinking about. So I did assume the role of, you know, Antichrist to America.
Marilyn's also been transformed for the band's new album, Mechanical Animals. It's still aimed at the beautiful people, but this time it looks at the aspects of fame and all that is Hollywood.
The album kind of examines my role in, now that I had put myself in the position of a superstar, and how that changes you, and how once you begin to finally feel things for the first time, how overwhelming it can all be. So from this record, I kind of come from a more vulnerable point of view, almost childlike or alien. I wasn't looking to piss people off so much with this video as much as show them the way I feel. And my imagery kind of represents the way I feel on this record. For me, the image that I used kind of represents being naked to the world, being fragile, being sexless, and being an image of wonder that people don't necessarily understand. I still stand by everything that I've done in the past, and think I'm still gonna keep those same enemies, because they're gonna always dislike me for whatever I have to say.
Just because this album, Mechanical Animals, rolls off the tongue, is full of kind of medical terminology, the stages of coma. Here, what is this back of the CD with the medical chart?
Well, this is kind of my world that I created, that I saw in my head, and it has a lot to do with what I saw around me in Hollywood. So it's a lot of analyzing the different elements of fame and of drugs, and just looking at them in different ways.
When did you come up with that line? I don't like the drugs, but the drugs like me.
All the time, people would say to me, "Hey, do you like these drugs?" And I would say, "No."
And then the drugs would say, but we like you, we love you. And I would say, no, please. Because there's a war on drugs, but I surrender.
You've surrendered? What does surrendering entail?
Well, what I discovered the other night when I was at Fred Niles' house, he was having a sermon with me, and he said, Marilyn Manson, it's okay, because Jesus Christ invented marijuana. And I said, really? And he said, Jesus Christ invented cocaine and LSD also. And I said, you know what, you're right, because if we're in God's world, then God invented drugs. And I said, you know what? If Jesus Christ can do drugs, then why can't we? And Fred said, you're right. That's when I can't speak about what happened after that.
Okay.
Sexual nature.
Should we bring Fred?
Yeah, you should ask him.
Fred, if you're watching, please come on the show. Please come on the show. We will tell your side of the story very fairly, let me tell you.
The thing that was very inspirational in writing the record was that I feel very alienated here. And where I lived on the hill, looking down on Hollywood, it was, it reminded me of outer space. And sometimes in the morning when I'd wake up, or if I hadn't gone to sleep, there would always be a bank of fog that kind of came right up to my window, and you couldn't see through it. And I had painted my entire room white, and it kind of represented just the emptiness that I was feeling. So I feel like an outsider in LA, but I like that because I feel inspired when I don't belong.
Yeah. Since you do talk about drugs so much, have you ever had a drug problem? And the thing where you say, well, I really have to pull back now, or just how have you avoided this? Because many people do.
I think the closest point in being overwhelmed by everything was at the completion of Antichrist Superstar. And I think getting through that kind of made me feel invincible, that I don't feel like I can be controlled by anything. I've always been one to promote the use and the enjoyment of anything, but when something becomes abusive, then I think it's more of a problem, or it's a downfall.
When is that? When you fall over?
I guess when you start making really bad records.
Rated X.
Welcome to the Launchpad Podcast.
Today on this album analysis podcast, I will be digging into Marilyn Manson's 1998 album, Mechanical Animals. Now, the first thing that will stand out to anyone who listens to this album after Antichrist Superstar is how much of a 180 it is musically and image-wise. The industrial metal sludge riffs are wiped away for spacey, intentionally over-polished glam riffs. The goth demon makeup has been traded in for a sexless alien getup. And it must be said that within all the many genres I'm a fan of, and I do pride myself on being a bit of a musical historian, I can honestly say, I think this change of sound and image is the biggest risk an artist has taken since this album has been released, all the way back in 1998. No doubt other artists have taken great risks, but I've yet to see the pure balls of knowing that you are easily liable to piss off half of your fan base, because as an artist, you want to prove that you are more than just simply a goth metal icon. Thematically at the time, this was introduced as a spiritual sequel to Antichrist Superstar, meaning the character is different, but the struggle is similar. An individual full of willpower and desire to find his special place in the galaxy, similar to the worm struggle to gain the acceptance of the beautiful people. Now, most commonly, people ask, okay, but why did he settle on a sexless alien? Well, to answer that, you have to look back to the controversy surrounding the Antichrist Superstar tour. Nearly all of Manson's concerts were picketed and protested. Some cities even banned him from arriving or from returning. His name was at the forefront of American culture. Manson noticed some people had no clue about his real message or who he really was. Rumors of wild proportions took hold. Most things were completely false and ridiculous, but many Americans ate up the falsities, and Manson continued to play on their lack of understanding. He felt that some people didn't know if he was a man or a woman, so he adopted the genderless in-between option. In today's culture, trans culture is a big talking point, but back in 1998, bringing something like this to America's front lines was absolutely unheard of. This was not something that would find any shred of acceptance, only strange looks and ridicule. In a quick sidebar note, I do find it curious that today's trans culture hasn't seemed to give Manson as much credit as he deserves for taking all the heat back in the day, trying to normalize the idea of accepting these societal outsiders at the time. Manson, in reality, wasn't even confused about his gender or anything, just embodying the character for the cause of making America assess their viewpoints and challenge their standards and beliefs. In many ways, he dragged the much-needed conversation of change a couple decades worth of progress ahead based on his unbridled commitment to this character. However, this character, Omega, is essentially a Ziggy Stardust of sorts. He comes from a planet far, far away, and his quest for acceptance has landed him on Earth. Now, there is some debate as to if this quest was forced, a la Lucifer's fall from grace, or if Omega chose Earth based on what he perceived as its potential, and I think that is an interesting path to consider. Omega has a message to communicate to everyone, and it's a very personal one. But he realizes right away that his real emotions appear less heard and less desired than his grand statements of more superficial topics like sex and drugs. In a lot of ways, this will function as the main theme of the whole entire album. Feeling like you are split in two halves because the world and those around you only want to see what they want to see. They don't seem all that interested in seeing you for who you are at your most vulnerable, or take the time to get familiar with the real, deepest version of you. They are far too content to stay on the surface, and this album personifies Omega's struggle with trying to blend both sides of himself to be the truest, realest version. Yet it seems like an insurmountable task in the land of mechanical animals, where his truest expressions lead to alienation. Similar to the beautiful people, the mechanical animals are a metaphor for the societal status quo. They are human, but mostly fake and emotionless, consumed with technology and utilized hive mind group style thinking. While the beautiful people were stuck in a cycle of monkey see, monkey do in terms of politics and religion, the mechanical animals are essentially seen as another updated version of that idea. Only this time, they've given up the religion and replaced it with their new messiah, technology. They let their technology rub off so much on them that they find themselves more and more like emotionless machines. Omega's journey to find the truth and his realist emotions could not occur at a more unfitting destination. Omega, thanks to his otherworldly look and opinions, is turned into a rock star corporate product with his backing band, the Mechanical Animals. Being dragged down by the pains of stardom, he has become more and more numb to the world, which only worsens when he keeps using drugs as both inspiration and coping mechanism. Instead of having multiple sides of the protagonist being revealed as the record progresses, like Antichrist Superstar did with the whole worm to angel to Antichrist metamorphosis, this time Omega's other side is found in Alpha, which is his quote-unquote true side, so to speak. These dualistic sides are present at the same time, yet Omega's is the only voice that seems to find an audience in the world of this record. While the Alpha side is the one that is holding on to his truest emotions, and he tries to deal with the toll they take on his psyche in this world of synthetic adoration and hollow meaning. Omega and Alpha are looking for something to make themselves feel whole, and it seems to be located in something called Coma White. At numerous points on the record, it gets called into question whether Coma is an actual romantic interest or a drug-induced hallucination or euphoria. 7 of the 14 songs are from Omega's point of view, and the others are from Alpha's. Omega's songs tend to be more bombastic and contained lyrics with superficiality and fame-drenched fodder, such as user-friendly, I don't like the drugs, and the dope show. And Alpha's tracks are more like disassociative, speed of pain, and coma white. The album artwork features a dual-liner notebook in which one half has the lyrics for Omega songs, and when it's flipped over, it reveals the lyrics for the Alpha songs. Next, I want to talk quickly about the decoded, hidden messages found within the album. When viewed through the original CD's transparent jewel case, or the transparent blue LP, one can read hidden messages that are written in yellow text in the liner notes, which, after the blue is applied, it becomes green and visible. The following is a list of all the instances of hidden text in the booklet of the CD version. On the main page, with the lyrics to The Speed of Pain, a blue message written in broken lines reads, Speed of Pain, in yellow. The SP is replaced with an FR, so the new message reads, Freed of Pain. On the same page of the color equation, the yellow text embedded between the big A Pill to Make You Numb lyrics says upside down in yellow, it reveals comawhite.com, which is an early promotional website for this record. On the same page as the lyrics to User Friendly, right underneath them is a diagram of washing your face in airplane facilities. Behind that, in yellow, again reversed, says, I no longer knew if Coma White was real or just a side effect. On the page that holds the lyrics to Fundamentally Loathsome and I Want to Disappear, at the top, in yellow, is the Omega logo. The words, A Sun with No Planets is Burning in Circles. Also revealed on the same page is a phrase, Now children, it's time for recess. Roll up your sleeves. On the following page, which is the page with the album credits, I found the lyrics to the hidden track Untitled that plays when the CD is inserted into a computer, and those lyrics are, In the end, I became, and I led them. After all, none of us really qualified as humans. We were hard-worn, automatic, and as hollow as the O in God. I reattached my emotions, cellular and narcotic. From the top of Hollywood, it looked like space. Millions of capsules and mechanical animals. A city filled with dead stars and a girl I called Coma White. This is my Omega. On the page which functions as an alternative cover reading Omega and the Mechanical Animals, a prelude to Manson's fourth album is shown when turned upside down. The phrase Adam 5 or Adam number 5 appears right above Manson's arm. Adam may be a biblical reference to the first man or number 1, creating yet another number 15 in this mysterious series of connections. And finally, on the page with the lyrics to The Dope Show, in the yellow text, it reveals, Even machines can see that we are dead. So now, let's dig into the songs and see what Omega's spiritual quest contains. Track 1, The Great Big White World. The album starts off with a very interesting line to set the table. In space, the stars are no nearer, which paints a good point. Omega slash Manson has been to space, aka Hollywood, where the stars roam, and by saying they are no nearer, it indicates that he doesn't view these people as stars, only imposters who are just as self-conscious as the common man. Glitters like a morgue. While dead inside, a fancy show is still on the outside. I'm not attached to your world. Nothing heals, nothing grows. I'm not attached to your world. Nothing heals, nothing grows. Omega is voicing his personal differences from that of his surroundings and societal climate. He claims they don't fix mistakes, and they don't evolve, content on the continuation of complacency. Omega longs for a sense of connecting in a land that is plain and hollow, drained of all colors and expression. A place where self-respect and love of your fellow man is tarnished. Yeah. Omega is making his first of many references to Coma White. Stitches itching and low prescriptions are his reason or excuse, depending on your point of view, to indulge in coma. Now, coma functions as a dual metaphor of a idealized romantic partner and narcotic numbing agent that will make you feel more at peace in a world that does not understand you. In a world so white, what else could I say? The nature of this quote-unquote reality is so plain and dull that the only sensible option would be to fit in with the crowd, to give into the crabs-in-a-bucket mentality, and fall in line with everybody else. Track 2, The Dope Show. The music video of The Dope Show was heavily inspired by a few films, one being David Bowie's film The Man Who Fell to Earth, another being Alejandro Jodorowsky's psychedelic spirituality film The Holy Mountain. And it, by the way, is a must-watch if you have not seen it. It's absolutely amazing. And also, the 1970s animated film, The Fantastic Planet. Manson appears red-haired with his entire body, including prosthetic rubber tits covered in white paint, as an androgynous extraterrestrial wandering around the Hollywood Hills. He is captured, studied in a laboratory, and eventually transported by limousine to a stage where he and the other members of the band, the fictional band Omega and the Mechanical Animals, perform the song in a concert before hysterical fans end up rioting and crossing security barriers. In a nutshell, this gives a good snapshot, or Polaroid, of the meaning of the entire Omega dilemma. His superficiality is celebrated and encouraged, while his truest thoughts must be locked away. The song has an infectious groove that sucks you into a mechanical arrangement signifying the war between man and machine. Omega is resorting to his sex, drugs, and rock and roll attitude and is surrounded by nothing but applause and approval. They say drugs make him feel hollow, but in reality, he does not see it that way. The drugs are something he can turn to because his environment is hollow, narcissistic, and shallow. This reflects back to some ideas on Antichrist Superstar. The rockstar universe has similar traps and traditions that people recognize to the extent that it becomes formulaic and bland. Omega is very much sarcastically poking fun at this notion right here. It's like he's halfway documenting and halfway delivering a warning.
We're all stars now in the dope show.
The Dope Show is a metaphor for the celebrity landscape. The more drugs and spectacle, the better, equating to how much more you'll be revered by the pretty ones. The pretty ones are a stand-in term for the status quo of the times. The pretty ones will be with you in good times, but leave you at your lowest, or when you're not popular anymore. And that backstabbing can blow your mind and shake your world up. This process mirrors fake relationships of all kinds, romantic or otherwise. This is another example of why you must tread carefully when you are around the pretty ones. The accolades he's experiencing aren't really Omega's, it's just his turn. Showing us as soon as you're in a low point or are not looked at as the new shiny toy anymore, they leave you in the dust. Which overall personifies the Dope Show as a pretty shitty place. Interestingly though, in today's current generation, Are things all that different, or have we all found ourselves living during the most current season of the Dope Show? Track 3, Mechanical Animals. Maybe we're once so human. The first thing to point out is how totally kick-ass the music is on this track. The guitar and drum mix is absolutely the work of genius. It dresses the scene like a film score. It is so cinematic, you feel as if you've been abducted into a sci-fi classic. Like if A Brave New World by Aldous Huxley was told in audio format. Which, by the way, A Brave New World was a critical influence on this album. Lyrically, Omega reveals via his alpha, more reflective side, a more analytical view of his situation. His thoughts are a lot more fleshed out and expressive in elaborate metaphors. Tears making them rust points to a Tin Man-style machine, human on the inside, but machine-like externally, where your human emotions and truest feelings will cause your outside world to corrode. This is a fascinating concept because it explores the dilemma of whether dealing with your emotions can be a hindrance. Is it better to keep everything bottled up inside to preserve how you are perceived, or should you shoulder your feelings and let the pieces fall where they may? Self-doubt is creeping up. Buried underneath the walls of resolve are lingering desires for improving not only his personal circumstances, but thoughts towards the potential of making a difference for others. Yet the self-doubt is most likely furthering the emotional tug of war. Not having confidence of your own power or influence, more often than not, leads to regret and self-containment, which, sooner or later, is always revealed to be harmfully regressive behavior. They'll never be anything at all. Another barb of dismissal. The concept of single-serving friends from the movie Fight Club comes to mind. Acceptance is had, but only briefly and superficially. This is Omega slash Alpha's declaration of distance between him and the mechanical animals. He views his circumstance as some sort of a forced corporate rock star alien who is simply playing the part of a dark villainous person who would appear to fit into the land of the pretty ones in mechanical animals, but deep down has a lot of vibrant emotions which cannot come out due to the pressure put on him from those surrounding him. And this is a thought-provoking burden that I think a lot of people can relate to in our society today. Track 4, Rock is Dead. Now, on this one, Omega is back, painting a picture of the decadent yet doomed climate. Monkeys with Alien Babies, which to me indicates old-fashioned, out-of-touch parents with futuristic kids they are not capable of keeping up with and intellectually handling. A form of evolution going out of control, if you will. Drugs for boys, ideology for women. Sampled, aka recycled, like rap samples. Soulless worldwide, everywhere is the same, and we are without any form of escape. Meaning both more safe, dead inside, or as an alternative, dead in real life. If you cannot fit inside the box of acceptance and standards mankind is currently offering, perhaps death would be preferable. Very deep thoughts intermixed with a catchy, fast-paced, bass-bouncing rock anthem. It creates an amazing parallel between just another kick-ass rock song and one that has something very intelligent to say. I think, far and away, lyrically, it's one of Manson's most underrated songs. In a comical way, Manson is revealing the kibosh to his own formula. Before and after this record was released, Manson was protested like no other. And here, he is telling them what they have been too stupid to understand. What they perceive to be shocking or immoral is only what they think. Hence, it's all in their heads. Nothing is factual and objective, just their own interpretation of the truth. This makes me think to how in today's society, many people walk around using the term their truth. And quite honestly, in a way, that kind of makes me want to puke. Reason being, if you look at the very definition of truth, there is only one. There is not my truth, your truth, the neighbor down the street's truth. Truth is absolute. There is no multiple versions of it. There are other perspectives, and perhaps even two sides to every story. But there is only one truth. Sorry for the tangent, but it's only another superb example of how this record remains so relevant today. God is in the TV, aka people are told who to worship by a predetermined programming. Full of hope and shit. The old phrase, hope in one hand and shit in the other, popped into my head when reading the lyrics. The conundrum of hoping or praying but taking no action, that maybe even a new god or ideology will suffice only to be another escape of a predetermined path instead of anything resembling self-improvement. The concept of being fake returns on almost every track on the record, and here we have another prime use of it. Dressed up portraying happiness, confidence, hope, only to be bottling up his true feelings of doubt, imitation, and numbness. And after rock is dead, we become disassociative. Track 5, Disassociative. The song references a time in real life in which Manson was provided ketamine from his then-girlfriend, Rose McGowan. Further details on this can be found in an interview where Manson explains why Disassociative is his favorite track from Mechanical Animals. And I must add on that statement that this also is tied for my favorite off this record with Coma White. Musically, it's everything I love about this record summed up in 4 minutes and 51 seconds. It has emotionally impactful hooks, and the lyrics and guitar work are so sci-fi and dreamy, like it came off the Blade Runner soundtrack. The drum machine gives that digital home base that drags you into Alpha/Omega's internal civil war between feeling, and it's one of my top 10 all-time Marilyn Manson tracks. Forbidden in heaven and useless in hell. He feels stuck in his earthly circumstances, yet even if he escapes to space, he self-doubts, aka floats in fear. Terrified, he'll drift alone, never reaching a place of belonging. A classic damned if you do, damned if you don't thought prison. Emotionally dying and empty like the vastness of space, Omega is coming to terms with the harsh reality that in all likelihood, this place will be the emotional and physical death of him, sooner or later. He's too different from what's accepted here, and the only way to fake it well enough to blend in is to keep taking Coma, which on the flip side will most likely only accelerate his downfall. Track 6, The Speed of Pain. Manson noted that the lyrical poem was written while on an airplane, and the intro features similar effects to that of an airplane engine sound. The speed of pain is a phrase which sums up the disillusion that this existence is instilling in Omega. The good times are fleeting and the bad times seem eternal. This song is essentially him questioning if this struggle is worth it, racing day in and day out only for limited rewards and more emotional and mental turmoil. I also believe that this is a dual metaphor, including the race of addiction. Continually using or drinking to postpone the forthcoming withdrawals that sooner or later will come back to bite you in the ass.
That I've known you.
this is an addition to the feelings of experiencing backstabbing and forced into being a product, a recurring theme that keeps rattling around in Omega's mind. Lies, tears, sacrifices, and death are all worth the pain Omega's going through, as long as on the other side of it, he reaches coma, the perfect idealized state of being, or idealistic love, he desperately seeks to hold on to. But seemingly, up to this point, it keeps slipping through his fingers like sand, elusive, and requiring a steady chase. The speed of pain is a pace that can't be maintained, and when the day comes where the pain catches up with Omega, he hopes to only be clutched in the nurturing arms of coma. Before I continue on, I want to point out that on numerous occasions, Manson has declared The Speed of Pain as the song he is most proud of writing. Which leads us to track 7, Posthuman. Zapruder is the name of the man who captured the most iconic footage of the JFK assassination. The government confiscated his footage and stuck it in a vault for over a decade before they finally allowed the public to view a revised copy of it, with numerous frames deleted, of course. John F. Kennedy was viewed in the eyes of many as a martyr after he was killed, hence the reference to perfection. JFK was a huge influence on Manson on this record and also the follow-up, Hollywood. The panned-off, high-register cadence the "this isn't God" part is sung in sort of represents a mocking tone of detractors, perhaps poking fun at the naysayers and protesters who Manson had been dealing with for years up until this point. Oftentimes, the religious right, or at least the social right, had been trying to tell him what to believe and that his message was dangerous, that they knew what God was, and he did not. And the way the phrase, "God is just a statistic," it is uttered in a clear contrast in terms of tonality that basically functions as a response to the prior statement. Manson / Omega's answer to this is, "God is a number that you cannot count to." The dead stars is a double meaning, echoing a thought of all the real stars / heroes are dead. And also, our current stars are dead inside, but still have a pulse. The riot, being religious and clean, points back to the protesters who treated him like dirt, despite preaching love your neighbor. I guess they feel like they only can love the neighbors they want to love. Posthuman is a term that better describes that idea of singing dead stars. post-human, still alive, but emotionally dead, or at least compromised, into behaving in a way that is tailor-made to please, instead of having a single kernel of true self. Track 8, I Want to Disappear. This track has a fast, punk-influenced vibe. Pure angst and aggression. Bottled up, shaken up, and ready to explode like a firework. Once again, Manson does a good job of exploring Omega's emotions in a way that also would apply to his audience. You can see the line between Omega's star persona versus the people he's attracting is starting to blur. Here, he's revealing he's becoming one of them, living down to what's expected of him. Not to get too deep here, but I think this points to Manson acknowledging that most of his fans come from some twisted walks of life. An abusive home, absent parents, makeshift households with fill-in step-parents. I mean, the idea of loving the abuse and trauma and repeating it because it's all you know and takes you back to that familiar feeling, yet wanting to disappear because you realize that pattern is unhealthy and unsustainable without having enormous repercussions later on. This is a further continuation of that last idea, getting into extra detail about the extremes this type of path will lead to, one where you are suicidal and feeling worthless. Manson detractors may point to the words as encouraging this type of behavior, but I think anybody that can grasp what's being expressed here will realize it's actually shining a light on it in a way to condemn it. A warning, you can use up all the drugs and you may not like them, but they might like you. Track 9, I Don't Like the Drugs, But the Drugs Like Me. First off, right out of the gate, I love this song. I love the glammed out, over-the-top catchiness, juxtaposed with the really dark and depressing lyrics. This formula is lifted directly from one of Manson's biggest influences, T-Rex. Now, T-Rex was a legendary glam rock band from the early 70s. They essentially began the glam rock movement, and then David Bowie and many others expanded on that original sound and gained success thereafter. A trademark of Mark Bolan's lyrics in T-Rex were either pop rock songs or songs that had pretty dark undertones to them, despite being dressed in catchy rock music. If you want to see a further example of this, I'd recommend listening to a song called Dandy in the Underworld by T-Rex. It was the last hit the band had before Mark Bolan would tragically be killed in a car crash at age 29. oddly enough, the other song that I think of that beautifully showcases this formula is a little more modern than T-Rex, but vastly different than Marilyn Manson. That song would be Hey Ya by Outkast. If you're familiar with that song, you'll instantly feel the free-flowing good vibe style of music, but if you go read the lyrics, you'll be stunned at how depressing and introspective they are. The song may be dressed up as a mindless dance tune, but at its core, it's a deep, hard hitter. Now, getting back to this all tying into I Don't Like the Drugs, the song lyrically is digging into opposing viewpoints from the normal life versus counterculture or drug culture. Toss that into a blender with confessions of discontent and probable drug addiction, you will get a well-thought-out, provocative piece of poetry mixed with a simplistic, bouncy rock song that almost anyone can groove to. This is probably my favorite lyrics from the song. Underdosed and ready to fall. Raised to be stupid, taught to be nothing at all. That's good shit right there. It also points me to a bit of justifying the drug use. As if saying, since you're raised and taught to be nothing, does it really matter what you do? Even if it's perceived as bad, such as falling into drugs? Is it any worse than the alternative that you're being shaped into by outside expectations? Interesting food for thought. Now, here we have a societal commentary rearing its philosophical head again. The masses at the time, and to a degree still now, are convinced God is white, and will send those who don't believe to eternal damnation, which doesn't sound like a forgiving type of character. These same people don't find a problem in the bizarre idea that your employer has a right to test what's in your body, regardless of job performance, as a means to control their investment or property. His last commentary on the norm lifers are they aren't really humans, only samples or a crash test dummy before the new era comes in, which either is going to realize the full human potential or further degrade us into turmoil and mindlessness. The use of I there could also shadow Omega's circumstance of being alien, not human, and feeling disconnected with his true north or soul. So this could again be an admission that despite how different they are, he shares a lot in common, the norm lifers, in how dull, disenchanted, and lost they must feel. This is a reference to Manson being blamed for a teenage suicide. After the release of the Antichrist Superstar album, a teenage boy was found dead by his father after apparently taking his own life. The boy was found with his headphones on, with the CD player still spinning Antichrist Superstar on repeat. This event caused lots of controversy and, if I remember correctly, a possible lawsuit against Manson. The talk show line is another jab at society, and their obsession with trash TV and the types of idiotic folks they gather to produce shows such as Jerry Springer. Drugs are used to mask feelings, giving a temporary gateway into the land of happiness and bliss, but it will sooner or later give way to a level of pain just as strong, and more likely stronger, than before using the masking agent of narcotics. And we can further see how this plays out as the record continues on exploring these themes in greater detail. Before continuing on, I'm noticing something that perhaps I did not fully comprehend in prior listens over the years. I'm seeing by digging into the lyrics back to back that in a lot of ways, this record's concept and storyline are told in a more abstract way than Antichrist Superstar. I think Manson is painting in more symbolic, broad strokes on this one, and even though the symbolism is strong on Antichrist Superstar, it just seems to me as if Antichrist Superstar was more meticulously drawn out, with the unraveling of a story of Worm to Antichrist metamorphosis. And the songs represent stages in that development. Where here on Mechanical Animals, it seems more that a lot of these concepts are mostly recycled from ideas expressed on other tracks. I don't mean to sound like I'm criticizing the album because I think it's great. It's just another tool of executing something very complex. But I think if you really dig into searching for meanings and treating every song like a chapter in a book, on this record, it does not seem as elaborate as Antichrist Superstar. And when the time comes to do the same breakdown for Hollywood, I'm extremely curious to see if it lines up more with Antichrist Superstar or Mechanical Animals, in favoring story or abstraction. Track 10, New Model 15. This is one of the strangest pop rock songs I've ever heard. I dig it though, but it's absolutely out of left field in comparison to something off Antichrist Superstar, or even Portrait for that matter. I think that of all the moments of social commentary on this record, this is perhaps one of the top three strongest. And I can't help but compare our current society to the backdrop of these lyrics and notice eerie similarities. Cancel culture and all that comes with this instantly offended, nerf the world approach just drips New Model 15. Have we all been turned into the new models without our knowledge? Unconscious robots to the influences and agendas around us? The new models are disposable, which makes me think of the societal rat race. The system tells you just enough to function, enough to punch a clock and hold down a job, but they don't want you to learn what they don't want you to know, or else that would jeopardize the doll-esque, dead-inside nature of their creations. Another interesting simile painting a picture of lack of identity. VCR/VHS tapes project the film or image you want to watch. If that creates what you are, you would essentially be mostly projection with hand-picked ideas and morals. Don't let them know how far you go. Points back to hiding your true nature in hopes of gaining societal credibility. As we've seen numerous times now, those same ideas keep circling around like water going down a drain. I return to thinking that the story of Mechanical Animals is more like a revolving set of concepts expressed in different methods and sounds, whereas Antichrist Superstar felt like an ever-unfolding story. So I'd say if Antichrist Superstar reads like a novel, Mechanical Animals reads like a comic book. Both are great works, but different forms of execution, which leads us to track 11, User Friendly. Track 11, User Friendly. Omega delivers another superficial glam jam. I love this song, and it's on my top 5 of this record. Everything about these lyrics signal detachment, dusting off the loving clutches and inspired confidence that coma induces, but amplifying the conundrum of real-life relationship versus side effects from drug use. It's almost as if Omega's journey to find a like-minded place that would care and understand him has entirely evaporated. As if he's completely adopted the traits of his surroundings, succumbing to the emotionless nature of the mechanical animals, where it doesn't matter who they fuck as long as they get what they want, until they find a bigger, better deal. And then they seamlessly erase the past like a chalkboard. This further amplifies the thoughts I just relayed. The ultimate act of love and compassion has disintegrated into a meaningless, almost assembly line state where real connection is lost in favor of convenience. Some would argue that this is also very relevant to today's dating scene, with swiping apps, images, and profiles being the main attraction point for many instead of physical, real-world connections. Maybe Omega was a prophet after all, and we've truly become the mechanical. Track 12, Fundamentally Loathsome. This marks the return of this album's intentionally excessive use of the word white. It's kind of crazy to think that Manson was actually questioned about being a racist due to the fact of how many times he said the word white on this record. Like, what the fuck? But apparently, many folks didn't realize the use of white vacillates between indirect drug references and also emptiness of the mind and emotions. This lyrical stanza is a nod to the numbing via drug use, which therefore causes the dullness of the mind and spirit shown here. This phrase digs deeper into the self-loathing, depressive state Omega/Alpha finds himself in. He can use hate as his fuel, and it makes him feel as if he has purpose to rally against something. Yet when he finally reaches comfort and love, it feels fake, and he's constantly waiting for the other foot to drop, revealing what he thought he had to be only a wicked illusion. The depression and disgust is weighing him down until he sinks. Coming to this world appears to be a mistake in this point of his reflection. Resigned to a world wicked and hollow, where the living are really dead, inside and of the mind. And he's trying like hell to blend in, to numb himself, in order to find acceptance among them. He wants acceptance, but the people here are not the type of people who he'd really want to be accepted by anyway. So it's a total catch-22. Why would you want to be like people you hate? Yet many of us, at some point in our lives, have probably been able to relate to this via real-life experience. Trying to impress people that it turns out aren't worth impressing. Trying to morph yourself into a version of something that would make you appealing to someone who is not worth changing for, only to discover you lost yourself in the process of a rigged no-win game. This reverts back to the idea that Omega's journey for understanding and peace through coma is in fact unhealthy dependency, regardless whether it's actual love or just drug-induced trickery on his feelings. He'd go as far to kill himself to prove he loves coma, which shows how little he actually values himself in comparison to her or it, depending on the use of drug versus love metaphor. And he confesses if he really respected and valued himself, he'd be turning the gun on her or it as punishment for the emotional roller coaster it's dragging him around on. Now, I think it's worth pointing out that a big influence outside of the Omega concept is from Manson's real-life relationship with Rose McGowan and his newfound fame. I wholeheartedly believe this song is a personal statement about those topics, as well as fodder for the Omega storyline, and I think that's an interesting thread to consider. Which leads us to track 13, The Last Day on Earth. The time is vastly approaching that the land of the mechanical animals will soon bring forth their own destruction. Omega realizes this and is making one last petition for change, one last push to make this place somewhere he can belong, one last chance to be united with coma despite the damning circumstances around him. References to Xeroxes and glass as physical parts of the body illustrate another example of the artificial nature of the world Omega's residing in. Empty without you refrains to the sentiments of fundamentally loathsome. His entire self-worth is wrapped up on the prospect of coma and outside acceptance. Without it, he's nothing. Yeah. death and destruction is all around, all encompassing. This planet will die because of its own hollow and disposable nature. Dogs slaughter each other, love burns and ruins, and all this death, catastrophe, and ignorance will be spilled at their children's feet, which could very well signal to the unfortunate possibility that this doomed cycle may repeat if the seeds sprout into a new version of this same old strange dogma. The destruction is imminent and unavoidable, far past saving at this point. Omega slash Alpha accepts this and will go down with the ship, so to speak, as long as he's in the clutches of Coma's warm embrace, never saying goodbye, facing the final end together. Which takes us to track 14, Coma White. With this track, before I start to roll the lyrics that stood out, I want to warn you ahead of time that this track will lead me to not only speak of it in terms of the Mechanical Animal storyline, but also Manson's real-life inspirations that helped fuel the creation of this track. So, here we go. Rose McGowan grew up in Miracle Mile, so you can definitely tell she was an influence on Manson's personification of Coma in the implied relationship aspect of Omega's journey throughout the record. Cold and blank behind her smile. Prior to Rose's relationship with Manson, she suffered an unfortunate abuse incident with that dickhead Harvey Weinstein, who she would later be the leader in taking down. In her autobiography, Rose proudly announces that Manson helped put her back together after the trauma she suffered, and she even reveals he wrote this song for her. Standing on an overpass is a subtle reference to her contemplating taking her own life, which Rose's book also touches on post her assault. Waiting to fall equates to waiting to fade away or die, essentially after the tribulations one has faced in life. Polaroid photos are an indication of remembrances from the past. Perfect world as in fame and Hollywood, flashing back to the sentiment of Dope Show on how fame and celebrity acceptance is all superficial and conditional. Love you today, but hate you tomorrow. The reference to running away points to running away from your problems and traumas. The pill references are clearly drug use related. Many people, and Rose included, have used drugs to blank out harsh past memories or to try and escape what's haunting them, only to find that the drugs are not a solution in any way, just a temporary patch on your outstanding problem. And this truth remains, regardless of how often or how many drugs you use. After all, no high can save you. I absolutely see this song as Manson trying to not only sympathize with Rose's situation, but also relate to it via his own experiences and life lessons learned. He's walked the walk of steady drug use and discovered that it's ultimately no answer. It's as if he's trying to use this song as a means to get her to understand the same lesson for herself. Now, you may be thinking, okay, great, it seems like an extremely personal song, but what the hell does it have to do with mechanical animals? And I'll address that end of it now. Won't save her from herself could easily be equally applied to won't save you from yourself. Omega's voyage through fame, sex, drugs, rock and roll, and self-loathing has delivered him to the same conclusion that Manson is trying to dedicate to Rose. Drugs and escapism in any form, even in a rock star fandom sense, will only lead you to worse problems and delayed solutions. So if coma is Omega's pill, so to speak, he recognizes he can't continue putting all his faith and self-worth into something outside himself, that his understanding he's ventured so far to find was really in himself all along. With coma as a relationship metaphor, it reaches a similar conclusion. Putting all of your self-respect and future happiness on the shoulders of someone or something outside of your own volition is a trap for endless heartbreak and disappointment. Learning that you cannot truly be loved and maintain love until you give yourself the love that you yourself seek and deserve. Then and only then can you find the true, unconditional connection you strive to obtain. And yes, I have spots available in my Love Life coaching course, in case you are wondering. Link in the description if you're interested. I'm just kidding. But this song remains a top two favorite for me in Manson's catalog, and I find it to be one of the most powerful messages he's ever committed to music. The music video drew a firestorm of controversy, as Manson is doing an open parody of the JFK assassination and Christ being crucified. When this video came out, many people protested and called for an immediate apology. However, Manson did not back down. But MTV's music video show, TRL, read a statement written by Manson live on air before premiering the video. And his statement says, "The Coma White video uses the Kennedy assassination as a metaphor for America's obsession and worship of violence. My statement was always intended to make people think of how they view and sometimes participate in these events. Little did I know that the tragedy at Columbine and the accidental death of JFK Jr. would follow. But it was telling to see that the media shamelessly gorged itself on these events, which ultimately made my observations in the video even truer than I had originally imagined. Coma White is in no way, shape, or form a mockery. In fact, it is a tribute to men like Jesus Christ and JFK, who died at the hands of mankind's unquenchable thirst for violence." Now, track 15 was the hidden track on the record, and I'm not going to reread all the lyrics because I read them at the beginning intro. I'm just going to do my comments on them right now. But this hidden track, this reads almost like a posthumous recap statement from Omega. He came and led the mechanical animals, despite finding out that none of them were really human thanks to their hollow thoughts and feelings. He tried to reestablish his own true nature, but only found he became one of the people he initially tried to save. Now, stranded in a place with imitative creatures and dead stars, a disposable culture is all that surrounds him. This is his Omega, or final end. And this is very similar to the end on Antichrist Superstar, where our protagonist is destroyed. The same goes for Omega. only instead of bringing on the destruction himself, like the Disintegrator did at the conclusion of Antichrist Superstar, here we discover that Omega's destruction was brought on by his surroundings and his reaction to those challenges, instead of by his own vengeful hand. As early as a month before this album's release, Kmart, Walmart, and Target refused to stock the album, citing the obscene cover and the expectation that it would carry a parental advisory sticker. In an attempt to appease some of the retailers, Nothing and Interscope Records discussed plans to cover the breasts on the album cover with a sticker and enclose the entire package in blue cellophane. Walmart still refused to sell the album and consequently pulled all previous albums by Manson. And this, my friends, was just the beginning of the adverse reaction to this album.
So the news about the new Marilyn Manson show isn't so much the production, which is a little more streamlined than it was the last time around, or the alternating blizzards of confetti and glitter, or the nonstop strobe light Armageddon. It's the band, which is fueled by a powerful new guitarist, and now kicks about 10 times more butt than it ever did before.
It sounds like a totally new band. The guitar player is fantastic. What's his stage name?
John 5.
John 5?
In fact, the other night, John got his, initiation because I knocked one of his teeth out on stage.
Excellent. Good news for the Manson band this year has been the arrival of Love, or something sort of like it. Manson himself has taken up with scream siren Rose McGowan, and Twiggy Ramirez is rumored to have interacted with none other than former Matt Dillon squeeze Cameron Diaz.
What is that all about?
The ladies' man thing? Yeah. I don't know. Cowboy, I guess.
Tell me about this Cameron Diaz thing. How did you meet
her?
You met that night?
We're, okay. I think we went swimming or something. Yeah. I was afraid that Matt Dillon was going to kick my ass or something.
I think it would have been really cool if he would have gotten a fight with Matt Dillon.
How'd you come up with this fabulous outfit you got on today?
I found it, actually. Yeah. I kind of found it.
Just lying around the back of the closet there, that kind of thing?
It's a little 80s metal. I wanted to bring back some 80s metal, you know. I figured, like, you know, the old Nikki Six kind of style, you know. He's not doing it anymore, so.
It's about time, isn't it?
You know, there's Gene Simmons, there's Nikki Six, so I figured now there needs to be Twiggy, you know, since those guys are, I don't know where they're at right now.
How about the pressure of following up last year's performance on the Video Music Awards by coming back again this year? Do you feel that performance was hard to top? Are you ready to try to do it this year?
I don't think it was hard to top about that. I mean, I'm not sure what we're doing this year because I haven't seen it yet. It's just, we're just sort of going to show up and see what happens. I think we should be okay. As far as, there's a lot of surprises.
Are you excited about the response to the record so far? Are you happy with the way people are taking it?
I'm kind of excited to see Courtney's breasts, actually. More than, although I've already seen them before, but tonight I hope she shows them.
Well, your dressing room is actually next to hers and Lenny Kravitz's, is that right?
Yeah, that should be interesting. I've actually never seen Lenny Kravitz's private part, so, but...
odds are good.
It would be, I would like to. I would like to walk in on him when it's getting undressed, because that'd be exciting.
Have you gotten to see anybody else just backstage hanging around since you've been here?
Master P, and I think Brian Setzer was going around, and he offered to shave my pubic hair, but I said no.
I think Brian may have some other thoughts about that, if I'm not mistaken. John?
Yeah.
Awards. Did you watch them last week?
No, I wasn't around.
It was good.
I was traveling that day.
It was very good. Marilyn was very good. He had on he had breasts and like a vagina.
Oh, really?
And his ass was like sticking out.
Did the cutout butt thing?
Did the cutout butt thing? You can see his butt. I think his butt's gotten a little. Last year his butt looked a little tighter.
Really? He hasn't been exercising?
I'm telling you, I'm gonna talk to him about that.
He's getting a little flabby.
I'm not a real big fan of this Everclear stuff.
Why not?
Every song has the same part. Down, 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 down. Yeah. It's like, get a new thing. But this guy, so I'm doing a commercial and also he's saying, yeah, when I was growing up, people said doing drugs is cool, and I found out the hard way. But I found out doing drugs is cool.
I don't know.
We should all do drugs. We should give some drugs.
Yeah. Hey, bring in Marilyn. He could shed some light on all this.
Marilyn.
Marilyn's real funny. He said, like, oh, no. I hope I don't have to suffer through another Puff Daddy song. There he is. I like this whole new hairdo you got, man. It's very sexy. Honest to God, Marilyn.
Why do our guests have to bend down to get in here?
Because they'll bang their heads on the cameras. Our show sucks so bad. You walk in, you could, like, have a lawsuit.
Marilyn had to crawl in.
Yeah, I know. Hey, Marilyn.
Hey, good to see you,
man.
Good morning.
To see you. Hey, I'll bust on the black guys. I'm not afraid.
I know you're the only one who's not. Jeez. By the way, brilliant performance on MTV.
Thank you. First of all,
the staging. Marilyn comes out in, you know, everyone's seen the picture of the new cover of your album.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mechanical Animals. And Marilyn's in, that's great stuff, man. I don't know where you got the idea for that, but you got breasts and, like, no vagina, but, like, it kind of looks like you got a vagina.
Well, you know what the problem is? Everybody hated me so much last year. As you can feel the pain.
Yeah, sure do.
But everyone loves...
Who hates?
Everyone loves...
Say now breasts.
Everyone loves...
Say breasts. Or else I'll be fined $1 million.
Everyone loves breasts.
Right.
So...
You
I
decided.
Get breasts, now everyone loves me.
Hey, this woman says Ben Affleck was bad-mouthed in Marilyn Manson.
Really?
Let's get the story. Lisa, what do you know about this?
Hi, Howard.
Hi, honey.
Well, I know a little bit about it. Ben Affleck was in town in Pittsburgh a few months ago, like mid-summertime, and a couple people were asking him if him and Rose McGowan hooked up. I think that's Marilyn's girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And he was like, no, I wouldn't. Me and Rose were just buddies. She's gained a lot of weight. She got real fat. And he said, I wouldn't have anything to do with her. And he said that she was only dating Marilyn to make a statement to, like, get notoriety, like an Anne H. Ellen DeGeneres kind of thing.
Hey, so
she weighs like 90 pounds.
She's really good looking. Yeah, she's real good
up
looking.
From 80, I guess.
Yeah. I think that he's a little bitter because he couldn't get laid. The only person that would touch his penis is Matt Damon.
Is that right? You don't know that for a fact.
No, I'm pretty sure that guy's queer.
I am.
You don't know that. I would know. I've had that in my mouth. And
oh, easy. You're killing me, Marilyn. Wait a second. Let's back up. You said a lot. you said a mouthful.
That gives you special knowledge when he's done.
Wait a second.
I have the authority.
Right, number one, you don't
hand out queer cards.
Right.
And that guy's carrying one.
You performed all this. When I saw you on MTV, you had on this outfit and you showed your ass again, which you love doing. But your ass did not look as good as it did the year before.
It didn't, did it?
It didn't. And I'm worrying that you're letting things droop back there. What's up with that?
You know, I have been on tour.
You haven't, or you have?
I haven't.
You haven't been working out.
Yeah.
That's your workout.
Running around the stage, huh?
You've got a fine little sweet ass. Don't let that change.
You know what I think it was? Right. I think that I've been sitting around with my big fat girlfriend eating donuts watching Good Will Hunting all day. My ass is gone to hell.
See, this girlfriend of yours used to date Ben Affleck? Is that what's going on?
No. She's in a movie with that Joker.
And he came on to her and he couldn't get her.
Get her, huh?
I'm going to say yeah if he sounds like that. You know?
Yeah, I hear what you're saying. Yes. I'm sick of him and Matt Damon.
Too much.
I wish the two of them would go away.
Too much of them.
Did you see any cool stuff going on backstage? Do you, like, does Madonna come up to you and talk to you, or, like, do they all blow you off? Like,
no,
you're some
you know,
kind of outcast.
I was just sequestered in my own area. Yeah,
they were afraid to shoot me. You know who
is
else?
That what it is?
Did you see who I had on stage with me? This amazing performer.
No.
The Goddess Bunny was standing behind Twiggy. Now, this is a
I know the Goddess Bunny.
A transsexual.
Yeah.
Transvestite. I'm not quite sure exactly what the definition
is. She's a drag queen.
By. Yeah. But she's physically misshapen from birth.
Right.
And so MTV was
afraid to show her.
They said, you know, oh, the world's not ready for this. And I figured, if the world's ready to see Dave Matthews' dumpy, weird shape, they can see the Goddess Bunny, for Christ's sake.
Now, why do you badmouth Dave Matthews? You said
I like Dave.
You do like Dave?
I'm
but you
single.
But you feel he's sexually attracted to you? don't you?
He put his hand on my knee in a real questionable manner.
When was this?
It was in Miami.
Really?
Yeah. My father was around, too.
So you have a witness?
Yeah.
So you were sitting there. Where were you, at a club?
Yeah.
Okay. And Dave Matthews, of the Dave Matthews Band.
Now, was it a momentary thing, or did it linger?
He was being real friendly, but I thought his touch was a little too gentle.
Did he touch your father as well?
No, he didn't.
He did not. That's wrong.
Trying to get a father-son thing.
A father-son thing,
yes.
Going. But you were
saying, like Dave Matthews.
You like him.
He's a nice fellow.
But you have been quoted as saying you believe he is sexually attracted to you.
Well, I mean, I can't blame him.
You're a hot guy, there's no question.
Who wouldn't be?
Who wouldn't be?
But you know what I like to do at the awards, and I did this. I did it in Madonna's dressing room, and I did it in Ben Stiller's dressing room. I like to urinate on people's toilet seats so they Ooh. Sit down unknowingly.
So you were in Madonna's dressing room?
I squeezed in there and took a squirt.
You did? Did you say hello to her? Did you have a conversation?
No, she wasn't there.
You got in without her being there?
Oh, yeah.
And you urinated in there?
Oh, yeah, on the seat.
Wow. Now, there's an exclusive. So you did that on purpose. You always do stuff like that.
You got to.
Is it all races that are into you?
You know what? I'm starting to think that that not just white people like me.
Really?
And
This is across racial lines.
That's wow. Even better, you know?
Right. So a lot of black kids aren't into Marilyn. Do they make fun of you because you're into a white guy? You're not into rap music?
I'm not into rap music. I don't really hang out with a lot of black people, I guess.
Really?
I don't care what they say.
Have you ever had sex with a white guy?
Yeah.
Oh, you have? Oh, that's a whole different thing. And how old are you?
18.
18? That's the age Marilyn likes to flower women. 18, that's right. All right, well, now's your chance to say something to Marilyn. Go ahead.
I don't even know what to say, Marilyn. Why'd you make me wait outside Tower Books for 3 days straight, and then you wouldn't sign my book.
What? Well, are you gonna yell at him?
Oh. No, I'm sorry.
I don't even have it now.
Here's what happened. It's really funny. What? She goes to Tower Books and she waits outside for 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
So Marilyn signs the first 500 books of people that are there, and I said, okay. How could you be out there for 2 days and not be in the first 500? And she didn't know, like, you had to go get a pass to wait online.
My friend Mike really wants to meet you. He's obsessed. He's like totally obsessed with Marilyn.
Well, then Marilyn doesn't want to meet
he's
him.
Outside.
Really?
He's about to cry, maybe. Yeah. Hi, Mike. I'm sorry.
Would he come in here and cry?
There. Yeah. Probably.
Would he be nude when he meets Marilyn?
I don't know if he'd be nude. He might show his ass and cry a little. I'm serious. He really,
Marilyn,
really wants to
meet his ass. Yes, I do. Do you enjoy this adulation? You like it, right?
Well, I think these people are great.
These are the fans.
Well, more than the fans, we're kind of like a group, you know?
Right, right.
Like summer camp, and I'm like the camp counselor.
Right, you're the lead guy. That's it.
This is a very weird summer camp.
You're leading the way. Let me tell you something. If your friend will come in here and show his ass and cry, that would be wonderful.
He's been doing all sorts of crazy things to meet you.
Hi.
Yeah. Now, dude, are you going to cry that you're meeting Marilyn Manson?
I can't cry.
Why?
I don't know. Just
you have issues?
I'm psyched.
You're psyched.
Yeah, I'd say go for the ass.
Well, let me see your ass.
He really wants to see your ass.
Okay. Pull down your pants and let me see your ass.
Oh, no.
All right, we're going to see this guy's ass.
Oh.
He doesn't care. He's so happy to see Marilyn.
Oh, no.
You see that thing. Oh.
That one hairy ass.
Wow.
What do you say, Marilyn?
My ass is bad. Should we look at my ass again?
Let me see your ass.
Yeah, let me see your ass.
Yeah. Seriously, Marilyn, pull down your pants. Let me see your ass. Because I'm telling you, Marilyn's ass has gotten...
But Marilyn's so skinny.
I'm telling you, it got flabbier or something. Hey, pull down. What do you got, regular underpants on?
What is he wearing?
He's wearing like Calvin Klein
underpants. Yeah. Or something.
Hold on, Marilyn's undoing his suit. Let me see that. Let me see that thing. Pick up your... Oh, it actually looks pretty... Robin, take a look at it.
Firm. What are you talking about?
Oh, it looks good.
That doesn't move.
It looks good. It looks nice.
Oh, man.
You know what I think? I explained this to someone. I think that suit that they put you in with the breasts...
Press
down on your ass.
It's like the fart man costume.
Yeah.
That's what happened to you, Howard.
You got
to
be careful of that when they fit you for this stuff.
Yeah.
Because you got a nice ass.
Thank you.
You really do. Let's all show our asses.
You're treading on some Dave Matthews water now, buddy.
Sure, I don't care.
I was going to say you're after it.
I'm Marilyn Manson. I'm here because my new album, Mechanical Animals, comes out tomorrow. Kind of the mark of a new age that I'm trying to make sure happens to bring some life back into rock and roll. I've just finished, as you all know, the MTV Video Music Awards. It wasn't very dominated by rock and roll, but I think that by next year maybe we'll be back on track and things won't be so geared towards R&B. There'll be a little bit more balance. I think it's been the music industry, along with conservative America, that has followed the era of grunge music and made rock and roll less and less relevant. It's something that I focused on greatly while making this record, and I hope that what I did is something that everyone enjoys, and I'd like to share it with everyone, and that's why I'm here today. So I'm going to talk about the songs and what went into making this record, and what I'm trying to give to the fans with this album. So you can keep it going. Please welcome Marilyn Manson and his bandmates, Twiggy Ramirez and Pogo. Thank you guys for being here. All right. Well, thank you for coming back.
Oh, thanks. Actually, last time you were here, showing up again.
You said that you'd come back around the release of the new record. It's nice of you to come back. Twiggy, welcome. Pogo, welcome. But visually very different, and we'll take a look.
Absolutely
right now.
Absolutely very different. Antichrist Superstar was a very pointed album, and it was a body of work that kind of represented the transformation that I went through from childhood till now. And it was more of an angry record. And the result of that is Mechanical Animals. You know, that record changed me. Writing that book changed me. And now I have a different look on life. The numbness wore off, and now I'm starting to feel things on a different level.
Right.
So it's a different kind of record.
And great, mind you. We've listened to it. It comes out tomorrow. What do you think of the setting of this room? I actually walked in and thought that one of these mannequins was you.
I did too for a second. I was going to have sex with
it. It's like one of those real dolls. Evan, how are you?
I'm fine, fine.
You have a microphone, Evan? I can hardly hear you.
Yeah, I got a mic.
Okay, good.
Your new album, Mechanical Animals, due out tomorrow, symbolizes a lot about drugs. And even in the booklet itself, do you feel that the media associate your album with drugs a lot more than usual?
Well, the album has to do with drugs is often used as a metaphor besides the obvious term. And while writing it and after going through the transformation of Antichrist Superstar, I began to feel again emotions for the first time, strangely enough. And the more I began to feel, the more and more the world started to look like mechanical animals. And that was the theme that started running through that. And I was kind of studying in my life and in other people around me, and particularly in Hollywood, how we numb ourselves and make ourselves less human and more mechanical. And I mean, if they want to attach to the drug thing, I mean, that's fine. I mean, that's been part of my life. You know, it's not something that I hide or deny.
What do you attribute that sort of feeling again?
It's probably worse than what I felt last year. You know, I think I put myself through a lot of physical pain to make up for no emotional pain.
Yeah.
And that's what a lot of people told me, kind of in retrospect, is that when I moved to Hollywood a year ago, I started to repair myself in a lot of ways. And this record lyrically documents that repair.
Jeff Hamilton is here, an actual youth pastor. Jeff, what's your question for Marilyn?
Actually, one of the things that I admire about this whole process has been your transparency from early interviews through these albums, the book, and you're talking about metaphors being in this particular album, and a return to realness and feeling in your life. What does that cost you then, emotionally? What does that cost you relationally, to move from that place of numbness to a place of feeling and interaction and processing with people and in your life?
That's a long question.
Sorry. Well, strangely enough, it's a lot harder than I thought it was going to be. You know, I set out to be something superhuman, something the greatest thing I could be with Antichrist Superstar. And what I didn't figure into that was vulnerability was a part of it. And that was something that I was not acknowledging. You know, I didn't want to feel. Now that I am, it's I'm sure everybody's been through, you know. I mean, it's what life is. And
it's crazy. People
love
you now.
It's like a rebirth. It's like being an infant. Everything's bright. Everything's very painful. And so in some ways, I've gotten back my innocence that I was looking for, you know.
You get some breasts and everybody loves you.
You can't hate them.
Yeah, hell no. Especially yours. Look better than anybody else's. Mechanical Animals also sort of seems like it would entail these people who do follow. And now that you're sort of aware of that, it's interesting because we have some diehard fans, Allison and Jeanette, is it, here, who have carved Marilyn Manson, and you've, I'm sure, met them before.
Yeah, they're friends of mine.
So how do you take to someone who would follow you to the point of self-mutilation? Is that sort of contradicting your own message of this don't follow the status quo?
It depends, because I can't say exactly what they're thinking, but to me, when I look at them and I consider them friends, it's their way of identifying you know, their way of being a part of something, because the rest of the world has shut them off in some way. And it's their way of expressing themselves, and I'm not one to judge how people express themselves.
Right. Is there any, this is going way too nice, is there anybody here who's not a fan? Anybody have the balls to say that? You're right here with them. Not you, Pogo.
my name is Rob Hayes. I'm a senior at Princeton University, and I'm also the president of Campus Crusade for Christ there on campus. I'd have to say I'm not necessarily a fan of your whole message. But again, this was something that I found interesting, is that if in my own intellectual pursuits, I find myself and happiness and joy in being a Christian, yet you preach that, you know, there is no God and that God does not exist. Is that hypocritical?
That's half true. You know, I'm more against the guilt that Christianity imposes, but I think that God exists in art, and there's more spirituality in music than you can find in religion a lot of times. But I'm not one to condemn anyone's pursuit of God or happiness or anything like that. I just think that we're raised to feel very guilty for being ourselves, and that's a large part of what Christianity stands for. But I think there's great and valuable things in the Bible. If anything, Antichrist Superstar was a lot of parallels with my life with someone like Lucifer. Mechanical Animals has a lot more parallels between me and Jesus Christ. So, you know, I've found a different way to relate to things. But that doesn't mean that I'm going to be a born-again Christian. It just means that I can find some valid points in your religion. I don't think that everything about it is wrong.
That's been a huge misconception, too, since day one. People thought that you were out there, like, protesting Sunday school. You've never done that. Where's Aaron as a Christian artist who's here? How's it going? What's your question for Marilyn?
Are you from Striper?
No. Striper's awesome.
Those guys from Striper do drugs.
I did drugs with those guys from Striper.
Yeah.
Those guys
are
must be
around. See what you guys are doing?
Nah, man.
Striper's our biggest influence. It wasn't for you guys.
It wasn't for Striper. I don't think Aaron's
the most
Striper.
Satanic band ever. But these works for you represent Striper.
No.
Aaron, what's you in? Like, you guys want me in.
What's your question?
I saw your new record, that A Symbol of Omega, a lot on there. And I noticed that you alluded to yourself as an Omega or whatever. And all I know of the Omega is that God said he's the Alpha and the Omega. What do you mean by that when you say that?
Very biblical references.
Yeah, biblical.
There's a lot of biblical references still on this record and a lot of numerological references too. But the Omega symbol kind of represents the final stage of what was set forth on Antichrist Superstar. So this is kind of the final evolution of whatever
before
it is that
after
I am.
Kind of a thing.
Yeah. But again, there is some allusions to Christ as well in this record. Yeah, it's looking at things from a flip side.
Wait, we've got another question over there.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead, man.
Your image has always gone through like these changes, and obviously God through art is something very personal to you. I was wondering, do you see your art going a certain direction? Is it more spontaneous? Like, can you foresee some of the changes that might come in like the next 2 years? Or is it just something that comes within on like a...
Well, I think we've really grown as a band, and we're kind of looking at this record as a new beginning, some, you know, a starting point. A lot of people would think that Antichrist Superstar was the most that we could do. This was our pinnacle, but it's really just the beginning for us, and it's hard to say. I think we're just going to always kind of evolve.
Right.
I'm inspired by what I see around me.
We're going to go right over to Gene. Gene?
Hi, great.
You have a mic? Okay.
Oh, yeah. I love your new look. It totally is great.
Thanks,
like, it's everything about indulgence and glitter glam. I'm so glad it's back and you guys are bringing it back. But regarding, like, numerology, you were talking about that. Your new font is, like, using a 1 and a 5, and then the release date's the 15th, and there allegedly are 15 tracks on the album. Can you elaborate on...
It's also January 5th is my birthday. I'm going to be 30 this year. That's half of my age.
And we, the address of MTV is 1515 Broadway.
Huh? The number Marilyn Manson also equals 6. There's a lot of different things, but if you look for coincidences, you know, you'll start realizing that there are no such thing as coincidences, that everything has a purpose.
That's what I
figure. One of today's most controversial performers, and this is his new CD. It's called Mechanical Animals. All right, folks, hang on to your stuffing. Here he is, Marilyn Manson. Marilyn, come on out.
We're all stars now
Which one is the young Republican? Hey, Marilyn, how you doing?
I'm good.
How are the folks?
The folks are good.
Good. You have a nice holiday? Nice Thanksgiving?
I was in jail.
You're in jail? Sorry to hear that. What were we doing?
Arson.
Really?
Yeah.
You set fire to something, didn't you?
Yeah.
Are you proud of yourself now? Do you feel like a big shot, like a big guy?
Well, they said I was mad in the Post, but I wasn't mad.
This is now, where did this take place here?
I was doing a little remodel.
Rock of Rages, Marilyn Manson in Hotel Rampage. Read all about it in the Post. There he is. And there's, they set fire to something backstage, and then there you are right there. So what's the deal?
See, what happened was, I looked at the dress room, and I felt it needed some remodeling. So I did some remodeling. Then there was a T-shirt that I set on fire.
Right.
Because it was very offensive.
Is this the kind of behavior, really, we ought to be pursuing at your age?
If you were me and you were in a dress room, wouldn't you do the same?
Not a chance in hell of that happening.
You actually haven't seen what I've done.
But seriously, because you're not a dumb guy. You know what I'm saying? What are you trying to pull here, son? Now, do the kids like you, don't they? The kids, do they take you seriously? Or the kids, it's just a joke, just a goof, isn't it? Just kind of a goof, right?
Well, everybody takes it for something different. It's entertainment. It's art. I'm trying to bring excitement back to rock and roll.
And how's that going?
It's going good.
Yeah. You know what you ought to do, because if we've learned one thing from Madonna, it's you have to keep reinventing yourself. So I'm going to suggest to you, and God forbid I tell you how to run your business, because look at you, you're $1 million now. Here's what you do. After the tour, you go away for a year and you record like a country album. You know, you go down to Nashville, and you know, kind of a Garth Brooks kind of deal. You know what I'm saying?
I borrowed this outfit from Garth Brooks. Except the problem was, he didn't have any pants that fit, so I had to just go with no pants. I brought some of my mom's bikinis. So.
More than you were counting on, ain't it? We'll be right back here with Marilyn Manson, ladies and gentlemen.
There's something coming up in a show called Gossip, and you were certainly a target for gossip in the last couple of years. Now, is there really any good rumors you heard about yourself?
I think they're all good. I don't really care either way. They all mean that people care enough to talk about you one way or another.
So, do you really follow it, or did you stop at a point reading everything about you? Or is it too much anyway?
My favorite one was that I had my rib removed so I could suck my own dick. That was my favorite.
Oh, that's a nice one.
I wouldn't be here right now if I could.
The new record is out. It's called Mechanical Animals.
Mm-hmm.
And it's it's kind of very visible that there's a constant reinvention going on with Marilyn Manson. So is that you, like, really choose different characters then?
In some ways. Also, Antichrist Superstar was a transformation, and I started one way, and the music that we heard on that album kind of detailed that transformation, and Mechanical Animals is the end result. So it's kind of the final evolution.
It's also clear that your looks have changed, like, from this video then to Beautiful People, that which we have seen before, and now that you're sitting here like that. And is it that you, when you look at these old videos, is that something where you think, I should have looked like I look now back then?
No. I think just when you start to become a visible image or a caricature or something that other people emulate, you have to constantly evolve so that you can remain yourself. You know, when more and more people started to look like me, then I had to evolve into something else.
Now coming up in the show is Long Hard Road Out of Hell, which was also the title of your biography. And now writing a biography, is that like ending a chapter for you? Because it wasn't a relatively early point in your career.
Mm-hmm. Since Antichrist Superstar was about becoming something else, writing the book was kind of a literary version of the album. And doing the album and then the book kind of made me change the way I felt and made me look at my life differently. So it was like an end to a certain part of my life, and I began again.
There's this little thing about Trendreznor in the book which has created a big fuss, and I've heard that you were not talking since then. So what has been going on? Is that true altogether?
We weren't talking before the book. The book just kind of told the story why. Mm-hmm. But we just basically kind of grew our separate ways. That's really the... There's no animosity or anything.
Okay, good.
And the new album, I think, kind of is evocative of the glam era of David Bowie and T-Rex and... even some of the 80s stuff, like the Eurythmics and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of evident on the new record.
So is that like citing the music that you grew up with?
Yeah, for the most part. But also just kind of bring some theater and some excitement back to rock and roll, because it's become so soulless and a lot of people have become real attached to electronica and... dance music, and it's, I don't want rock and roll to lose what it's about. So this record is very rock, and it's, you know, one of the last hopes for the genre. We got together and we came up with the idea to kind of compare a drug lifestyle, Hollywood, to that of... being dissected and picked apart like an alien. And there's kind of a parallel between the two, and that was the concept for the video. I think people would get bored, and I would get bored myself if I were to do the same thing over and over again. Mm. So I just want to continue to do things that are interesting and make people think. I'm gonna punch you in the fucking teeth.
Thank you. like, oh. Hey!
My name is Jan Terry, and I'm a singer-songwriter. I'm a friend of Marilyn Manson's, and I'm doing a private performance for him and his band.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the drug capital of the world, Hollywood, California, Omega and Mechanical.
John talks to any girl that has tits. Take a look. And I washed up on a beach made of cocaine. The sky was made of LSD. And every tree was made of marijuana. But the cops pulled me over. But they did not arrest me. They sucked my dick. And when they were done draining every last drop of cum out of my cock, God came down from heaven. He said to me, Marilyn Manson, we will no longer spell the word God, G-O-D. And I said, how do you want to spell it, God? He said, give me a D! Give me an R! Give me a U! Give me a G! Give me an S! And what does that spell? I don't like the drugs, but the drugs like me. The drugs, the drugs, the drugs. Ooh.
out the exotic dancer directory, Pogo, which tells you where strippers are in every city across America.
Out of these 2,000 girls, how many do you think you know?
I don't want to answer that question because it'll make me feel like an asshole.
Sniff it again, Pogo.
Okay, Smokey.
The second time, snaff it. The first time you sniff it, now you gotta snaff it. And if you do it once more, you're gonna snoof it.
Wait a minute.
Worked.
Here you go. That was perfect.
Ginger, but we have to do this.
Oh, that smells like vinegar.
Oh, my eyes! I'm never gonna see again! Get me a medic! Get me a fucking medic!
That's really weird.
Wow, you smell like a fantastical little tonkatsu sauce.
Oh, this smells awful.
Wait, let me try it again.
No, that hurt.
These things would get hard. They see, Mike, these aren't suitable for eating. This hurts someone, duck.
Oh. I love to introduce myself. My name is Mud.
That was good. Good job, Fi.
Is that your kid?
One of many.
It looks a little bit like you, Pogo. Pogo, kiss the baby.
Kiss the baby.
No. Why are you doing this?
Kiss the baby, Pogo.
No.
Kiss the baby, Pogo.
I don't kiss the baby. What are you doing to me?
Show me your face.
No.
Uncover it.
No.
Uncover it.
No.
Eric said that herpes is a small price to pay for true love.
Your father can't hide his behavior.
Your attention, please. We are about to conduct our sound check. It is a closed sound check.
My friends call me Pancake. Yep, Pancake Nipples. Put some butter on it. Oh, yeah.
Yes! Kevin is a champ. You better run, Kevin, before you get into some trouble. Back up. Who's it?
Mushy, mushy.
Weeping.
Oh,
Yes.
What's the spirit of pyro?
With the pyro? No pyro.
Watch your feathers.
None at all. The fire marshal's here with warrants in hand. If anyone lights anything on fire, they spend the night in beautiful Pittsburgh jail. See, the problem is that the burning of the item at the end of the show is not on any pyro spec list. So, in essence, it's illegal. That's Manson goes to jail.
Here it is, right here!
In red, white, and blue.
Look at this, disposal. The flag, when it is in such condition that it is no longer a fitting emblem for display,
should be
destroyed in a dignified way, preferably by burning. Well, it's not ready anymore, and I'm gonna burn!